Mahayana Buddhism later on, by which time image worship becomes well established in the Indian subcontinent. I mention these ideas as something of a background because the material that I am going to be looking at from Chandraketugarh and from the sites around which with which I am going to compare it have to be contextualized in this broader religious background of what is happening to image worship and to image to religious narratives. That's the larger context within which we must study our images. Now, Bengal is not the only region which is rich in these kinds of images. These images have been found from all over the Indian subcontinent. The first image of the type that was ever discovered was this figure. It comes from Tomluk and it is now at the Ashmolean Museum in Oxford. In about 1870, it was put before the Asiatic Society here in Calcutta at a meeting, and a number of people deliberated on this image and on this plaque that had been found, and then mysteriously disappeared from Calcutta, and it turned up at the Indian Institute in Oxford in 1920, where Johnston, the famous Sanskrit scholar, discovered it. And then when the Ashmolean Museum had a new premises, it was put into the Ashmolean Museum. And it has intrigued scholars ever since its discovery. It is the most written about plaque of the Shunga period, and it is considered the great exemplar and the great great prototype that everyone studies. I'm just going to briefly look at it with you. As you can see, this is the standard. As I was saying, it's a very typical type of figure. So most of these terracottas are punched out of molds. The molds are extremely refined. They show a lady very often standing with five hairpin-like projections that come out of her hairdo. She seems to wear an elaborate turban. They're usually five, but they're not always five. They can be 10 or 12, sometimes as few as three. In some parts of India, the five weapons on one side are counterbalanced by five sprigs of foliage on the other side. She's always very elaborately jeweled. I've written separate articles on understanding and analyzing the talismans on her body. If one really takes a zoom lens and a macro, does some macro photography, one can notice that the pendants that are falling on her thighs are actually in the shape of small Bharvahak yakshas. And the pendants which are on her torso are actually figures of small animals with a fish tail, an elephant with a fish tail, or a bird which is flying, or a deer which has wings, and other such features. So mythical composite creatures, partly different animals being put together to create some fantastic beasts which have been put across her torso. I'm sorry, the magnification is not enough to see that over there. Now, the curious thing is that the dating of the sites in the Bengal Delta is actually a very tricky thing for archaeologists to establish. Whereas in the rest of India, we get archaeological sites which are in the shape of mounds, and then you can very neatly achieve strata, and then you can dig down. The Bengal Deltaic area is so waterlogged that after about 8 to 10 feet of soil, you come into slide. You come into a pretty wet, waterlogged territory. And the deeper you go, the amount of water just keeps increasing, and the clay is constantly churning. And actually, you're not just digging in, you're not digging in soil, you're digging in a kind of a liquid clay. And it's a very curious thing, because every time there are major tidal shifts, the soil on the under the land, the water under the land is also affected by that. And you're not going to get neat stratigraphy like the way you get the kind of stratas that you get for dating that you get in the rest of the subcontinent. It also seems, as now current research has shown from the work being done in Mahastangarh, that It seems that the settlement of the Delta region, the 24 Parganas area, happens much later in history. And this really is one of the, although the upper reaches of Bengal had a much older history, these lower portions of Bengal get settled only at a much later date, from the early Mauryan into the Kushan period. What happens during that period is that the settlements keep shifting. Chandraketugarh is not a single site. Chandraketugarh is in fact a site that is spread well over 8 square kilometers. 8 square kilometers, yes, certainly, but actually the series of habitations seem to continue and extend all the way down the delta. And in fact, there are even portions in the Sundarbans that have revealed objects which are quite similar to what we find in Chandraketugarh. In that case, the question becomes that is this such a major urban settlement, all inhabited at one time? No, it's not. It seems that it is a migratory population that is moving from one settlement zone into another all the way along this area, and the objects keep developing in style. So you can see things from one portion of the broader Chandraketugarh zone, as I should call it, rather than the site, because it is not a single site, which shows evidence of a certain group of, from a certain date, and then you move to the next village and you see material from maybe 100 years later or maybe 50 years later, and then you move a little bit beyond and you see things which are made a few decades later. So it seems that it's a shifting population, and that can create certain curious objects. It also needs to be said that the stylistic development that we see in Bengal has a slightly different trajectory to what we find in the rest of the Indian subcontinent. So some of the more recent discoveries that have been coming out from Murshidabad area, for instance, and from Bangladesh, just across the Khai, you get objects like these little Gupta period images of the Buddha, but the flanking figures that you see on either side seem to be dressed in a Satvahana or a Kushan costume, especially with regard to their turban. Now, this causes certain curiosities in one's mind if one looks at this related figure, again, a sort of a Gandhara style drapery inspired by that, but the way the figures are shown praying to the central figure at the bottom are very much in the style of Amaravati and Nagarjuna Konda Satvahana figures. Or this one where you see a very direct correlation with a Mathura style in the central figure. So although the central figure is of a Gupta style, these are supposed to be finds in the region of Murshidabad, Karnasovarna, going across the border to Dalshahi in that zone where these objects are being discovered. They bespeak a slightly different chronological and stylistic development compared to what we find in the rest of the Indian subcontinent, an admixture of styles which is curious. All the scientific tests that have been done on these objects from multiple laboratories in the world corroborate that these are about the 5th century AD. But these are not the kind of objects that I really want to talk about. I only brought these up to show you that the chronological development of style in Bengal is curious and not exactly like what we find in the rest of India. The kind of objects I'm more interested in speaking about today are amongst those thousands of terracotta plaques that have been found, which remain like nameless deities, the nameless little plaques that we don't know who they are representing. Might be one seat over here in front if somebody wants to sit down. And if you don't mind sitting on the floor, there's some space here in front, you'll get a clear view. It's better than standing at the back. Okay. The kind of plaques that I'm more interested in, that have been curious, have been these figures, which show a lady sometimes standing next to a freestanding pillar. This particular one, the lady is clearly in a tribhanga. She's got some attitude of dance. Her arms are raised. She has a small cat beside her. But the pillar which is next to her, that freestanding pillar, is very curious. It shows on top of it four elephants with their trunks raised. And above it, there is a Bharvahak. You can't see the Bharvahak because he is partly concealed by the lady's elbow and partly concealed by the peacock's plume. And the peacock sits right on top. So you can see just the hand of the Bharvahak there and the foot behind. So there is a Bharvahak sitting behind the peacock, and then there are these elephants, and then there is the freestanding pillar. Now we often wonder, what was the cult of the freestanding pillar associated with in ancient India? And I have another detailed study that, apart from any other reason, any other meanings that might be associated with the freestanding pillar, one of them was, of course, the cult of fertility. And that fertility aspect is borne out by another plaque that shows a mother bringing a young boy to pray along with a plate of offerings to a similar freestanding pillar, again with the elephants on top and again a peacock seated right on top. So what we are being able to see in a number of cases is that the cult of the pillar is not unrelated to the cult of fertility, which is being associated with a lot of these figures. Now, what I'm going to come to and show how is this distinctly associated with any cult that is Buddhist in nature, and why should we be linking such practices, such ritual practices, with Buddhism? Keep that thought in your mind, because we will come back to it after looking at some other evidence. This is going to be a slightly cumbersome journey. The evidence has to be built up in stages. It's not going to be immediate. You're not going to see the connections. Okay, so let's get back to the Tamluk Yakshi, and let's look at her iconography. The curious thing is that we could never understand what this figurine meant. Why was this figurine made the way it is? Now, if we look at this old Archaeological Survey of India photograph of the excavations from the Piparava Stupa, which is, as we know, the most sacred of the ancient Buddhist stupas, which was most likely to contain the Buddha's own ashes. It contained inside one of its relic caskets this gold plaque. There was some controversy whether it was from Lodhiyanandangarh or from Piparava. There are other objects which are from Lodhiyanandangarh, which I'll also be showing you presently. If you look at this lady carefully, you'll see that she has the same projectiles from her hairdo. And that seems to indicate that the lady with the ayudhas is not somebody who is only to be interpreted as Lakshmi or a Proto Durga or something, but also to be looked upon as somebody who is so important that she is kept along with the asthis of the Buddha inside a relic casket in the stupa. In the most sacred part of a Theravada stupa, inside the relic casket, you put an anthropomorphic figure. Now, the rise of the question of anthropomorphism in Indian art has always been linked to the rise of the Buddha image. But here we see that in the most sacred ancient stupas, a different kind of figure is being put inside the relic casket. Of course, one could make the argument that they were just interested in putting something made of gold inside the relic casket. Like, after all, in Gandhara, they put the coin of Kanishka inside a relic casket. They don't necessarily have to put the image that they put inside the relic casket does not need to have some meaning associated with it. It could just be there because it is made of gold. That would be okay, I would believe that argument, were it not for the fact that the other casket also contained a gold plaque. And that contained a gold plug of this kind. You can see where you can see just the outline of a figure, a broad-hipped woman. Her pudendum is clearly visible. Her arms are falling by her side. This one was found at Gauriya Nandangar. Again, it's in this museum's collection. A third one we can look at, which also comes from Petrava, shows this particular lady with her arms falling by her side. More gold in this case. There seems to be a regular occurrence of putting an image of one of these goddesses inside relic caskets in eastern India. In the most ancient relic caskets, not in the caskets of Madhya Pradesh and not in the caskets of Punjab or Sangor or beyond in Gandhara, but let's look at the caskets of Bihar and UP and Bengal and see the kind of the borderlands of Bengal and see what are the kind of things we're getting from there. Because those are, of course, the more ancient stupas. And it seems that this goddess seems to be in all of them. Now, for those of you who are students of Indian archaeology, will immediately be able to recognize that the shape of this lady is none other than the kind of figure that we find inside the ring stones and disc stones of the Mauryan period, where we find the same kind of figure is made inside these mysterious Mauryan ring stones. And we've never been able to fully understand what was the meaning behind these Mauryan ring stones. So what is building up is that the same kind of lady is obviously so important that she is placed inside the relic casket. Now moving on, I'd like to look at another example. Although we found examples of her in gold and in clay, sometimes in bronze, there's one very famous example in bronze, which is in the Metropolitan Museum in New York. There is one example which has been found which is made out of stone. And the stone one also comes from a Buddhist context. And that is unusual. It comes from South India. It comes from Goli. Now, this is a life-size sculpture. If it was complete, it would be 5 feet high. And if you look at her carefully, she has these pin-type projections coming out of her head on both sides. The sculptures of Goli are dated to about 300 to 350 AD. It's a late site. It's made out of Palnad limestone. It was excavated by, it was, well, excavated is not the right word to use. It was picked up by Jouvaux Dupri, who took the sculptures over and deposited them with his friend, the very famous art dealer called C.T. Lou, who had a shop in Paris. And from Paris, the sculptures of Goli made their way, like the Kanchipuram Yoginis, to many museums in the Western world. The sculptures that C.T. Lou, this particular sculpture, was bought by Douglas Barrett, the former curator of Indian art at the British Museum, for the British Museum's collection in the 1950s, 1954. 55 it was accessioned. And you see that it has an inscription right on top. I made a rubbing of the inscription. I tried to get some akshars out of it. My speculative writing of the akshars is not to be followed. It's very hard to make out what is written in that. The inscription is very weathered. The point is not what the inscription says or doesn't say. The point is that this is an object which is, here is a cross-sectional drawing. This portion is the only portion that is occupied by the piece of stone right now. It has this lenticular mortise cut into it on one side. It would have had two such mortises. One side also has evidence of a mortise into which the Vedika railing pillar, the crossbars, would have slotted. So this is that. What is surviving is this portion of the Vedika railing pillar. And that means that this was a sculpture outside a Buddhist stupa. Once again, we find that the lady with the projectiles, I don't know what other word to use, the lady with the projectiles is found in a Buddhist context. So not only is she found inside the relic casket of some of the most ancient stupas, she can also be found now on a Vedika. right from the late Satvahana Ikshvaku period. Now let's move away from these goddesses. Let's try and build up the case for another group of figures. And I'm now going to come that if Buddhism is being practiced in Eastern India in the domestic environment, this should not be limited to just these mysterious goddesses. It should also be there with other types of standard Buddhist figures. So I'm going to examine this figure with which I began my talk, which shows a plaque that is now, that could be interpreted either as a Maitreya or it could be interpreted as Siddhartha, as the Gautam Buddha, actually. I'll come to my interpretation of that in a second. I want you to look at what is going on. There is a figure under a tree. A monkey is peeping from the tree, looking upon the scene, and all the ladies and people who are gathered around him are awestruck by him. Many of them fold their hands. They are struck by this man. The curious thing about this man is not that he holds this object. It's not really a kamandal, but it could be something like a kamandal in his hand. If we interpret it as a kamandal, then clearly it is Maitreya. The more interesting feature about him is, look at his feet. Under his feet, there seems to be two tree trunks, or something that looks like tree trunks, which has lots of stripes on it. If we zoom into that and look at that really carefully, it could be interpreted as two tree trunks, but it's more likely to be gushing water coming out from under his feet. This is very much like the story of the Buddha's miracle of Shravasti and the other times when he is supposed to have descended from Tushita heaven, when he is shown in Gandhara many times in the same way, with water coming out of his feet and fire coming out of his shoulders. However, in contemporary sculptures from the Ikshvaku period in Nagarjunakonda, wherever they show the descent of the Buddha, they don't show the fire or the water. It is simply understood that the Buddha, who is shown levitating, is shown simply levitating, not being stuck in the sky, performing the miracle, not shown with the water or the flames that we find in Gandhara. But for those of you who are not familiar, let me show you what the Gandhara ones are like. This, for instance, is the very famous one that is in the collection of the Musée Guimet, which shows the Buddha with the flames and the water under his feet, water under each foot. The one in the Musée Feenwisch Kunst in Berlin, again, has the water under the feet and the flames. And here, our figure also has the same water under the feet. So what I'm trying to say is that what we have been doing is retroactively reading the iconography of Buddhism on the basis of the way in which Buddhism was imaged in Mathura, in Gandhara, in Sanchi. And to say that this is what the iconography of Buddha should be like. We've not actually thought that there could have been a parallel system of iconography that might have been valid in Bengal, where the same myth is being shown to us, but with a different attire, a different iconographic system, a different hairstyle and a different costume. Why is it necessary that all parts of India should be following exactly the same costuming method at the same time? Why is it not possible that Bengal had its own regional tradition of Buddhism? Now, for Buddhist scholars, this is becoming increasingly important to recognize this difference, because the discovery of the Pali of the texts that are coming out of Gandhara, the Kharoshti manuscripts which are coming out of Gandhara, are revealing to us a parallel tradition of Buddhism that was being practiced in Gandhara, which was not the same as the dominant form of Buddhism that we have learnt was being practiced in central India. In any case, most of the myths and stories that we know of Theravada Buddhism were reconstructed on the basis of the Sri Lankan canon of Buddhism, and not taking into account the Southeast Asian canon of Theravada Buddhism. You see, for those of you who may not know, and these experts should forgive me for stating certain obvious things, the whole history of reconstructing Buddhism in the 19th century in India was done on the basis of certain texts that were rediscovered in Sri Lanka, because Buddhism was all but dead in the Indian subcontinent. And that was used as the basis for the reconstruction for what the early Buddhist stories and narratives were about. So reading the Sri Lankan chronicles, people were able to identify the stories of Bharat and Sanchi and so on. This was correlated with a group of texts that was later discovered from Tibet. And those Tibetan texts were used to also try and helpfully reconstruct, Chinese and Tibetan texts were used to reconstruct what was happening in India. It's only now that another group of texts has been found, which is from Gandhara, which are from Gandhara, that are showing us a parallel system of Buddhism that might have been active in their regional school over there. In recent years, a lot of work has been done by, for instance, Peter Skilling, who works in Thailand, who has shown that Southeast Asia had its own traditions of Theravada Buddhism, which they probably inherited directly from Bengal. It's likely, therefore, that there was a variant tradition of Theravada Buddhism that was active in the region of Bengal and coming down the coast to Orissa that we don't really have evidence, textual evidence for. These kinds of plaques may be evidence for a slightly different reading of the Jatakas as they might have existed in eastern India at that time. And that is why this visual evidence is particularly relevant for us. Let's look at another grander example. This big plaque shows a figure who is outside a palace gate. And the figure has a lotus-shaped pedestal under him. He holds a kamandal in his hand. He has a halo behind him. He has an unusual gesture. And this gesture comes up repeatedly in the images of Bengal. It is not Abhaya Mudra with a straight patak. It is in fact the Vajra Mushti, which is the hand bent in a cupped gesture. And it is very curious that repeatedly we find these images in Bengal of Buddhas all the way up to the 5th century that show a convention of the hand in this gesture rather than this gesture, which is the norm in Uttar Pradesh. Right? So whereas from UP and west of UP, that is the gesture of the straight pataka, it seems that the earliest images in Bengal deploy a slightly different gesture. Again, what's interesting is everyone seems to have gathered. There is a procession. Somebody is passing a kamandal down from an upper balcony to a figure in the procession that is marching through this palace gateway. And everyone seems to be coming out of the palace into the area of the forest where animals and men have gathered to salute this holy figure. Who could this figure be? Could this be a depiction of the great departure and Buddhahood? Or could this be, because of the water pot in his hand, be a depiction of Maitreya? The idea that it might be Maitreya in this gesture can be found in another group of pieces, and I'm sorry I don't have good quality pictures. These were photographed when I was doing field work in some of the islands of the Sundarbans, and they were taken on a phone in a hurry when the people who were discovering the pieces were not really well disposed towards me, to put it mildly, and not really keen for me to use my camera to take the kind of pictures I was. So for instance, this is one of those extraordinarily large pots. I don't know if you can make out, I'm sorry about the poor quality of the picture, but there is a figure in the center who also has a kamandal in his hand, a halo behind him, his hand in the same, held in the same pose, and people are worshipping him all around. Again, in much the same way that we saw in the previous plaque over here. Now this plaque again has been scientifically tested in many different laboratories. It gives us a very clearly 2nd century AD date. This has not been scientifically dated. I put this out to everyone. I've seen this. I saw it on the coming out of the where they found it at that time. But I'm told it has been purchased by an Indian art collector. So it's still within our country. And it's one of those where we're lucky that it's one of those pieces which is still in India that has this rich iconography. Now, building up the case for bodhisattvas, I'd like to show you this particular ivory wrangle. This remarkable object, when I first encountered it about 12 or 15 years ago, I thought that I had found evidence for the Hindu deity Agni, because Agni is always shown riding a ram. And I went down a line of research for many years, probably because I was reading too many popular Bengali novels or something at some stage, or was being narrated to me. And I began to think of Chandraketu Garh and the name Chandraketu and this idea of the grahas and the idea of how the different planets are so important and how iconography of something like Agni, who is one of the Dikpals, might have an older system, an iconographic system in Bengal, and how Brahmanical deities might have been there. And I was thinking all these things for a long time till I realized I was being completely foolish one day, when an object that I had always known all my life came back to see me. And when I saw it again, which is of course this very famous Gandhara statue in the Victoria and Albert Museum that shows the Prince Siddharth being taken to school. And of course it's true that in the early Buddhist literature, in the Jatakas, it says that Siddharth was taken to school on a cart pulled by rams. And it was beautifully depicted in Gandhara about 5 or 6 times. This is the best example. And you can see how the iconography of the boy being taken on a cart pulled by rams is similar to what we find from Chandraketu Garh in ivory. What's the similarity? What's the difference? There is a similarity in the mythic narrative, in the content. There is dissimilarity in the costuming. Is that so unreasonable? That Buddha might be dressed and Siddharth might be dressed differently in Bengal to how he was dressed in Afghanistan? Must we expect complete parallels in iconographic systems at a time when the iconography is only just emerging and just being developed for the first time, when it is at such a nascent stage in its development? Will there not naturally be variations where every region of India experiments and shows the deity in their own way? Now let's move away from bodhisattvas and let's look at something else. Buddhist stupas are mostly associated with stories of jataks, and the jatakas are animal fables. Now the curious thing about these animal fables is that they could be Hindu or they could be Buddhist very easily. If you are following the Brihat Katha and the Hetopadesh or the Panchatantra, the story has a Hindu reference point. But the same story of the elephant and the crocodile will be there in a Jataka context. What is also interesting is that outside stupas, you often have these talismanic morphed creatures. Winged elephants, griffins, sphinxes are very common. If you look at, for instance, Sanchi Stupa 2 or Mathura, you will find a number of sculptures of these morphed creatures. And we find exactly these at the same time from the Chandraketu Garh terracottas. Could it not be that a number of these plaques were attached to a wooden armature of some domestic or some local stupas, where the wooden armature has been destroyed, or we sometimes find large wooden posts, but we don't know how these terracotta plaques were used? And it seems likely that if we attach lots of these terracotta plaques together, we can build up complex tableaus where large narratives can be constructed. by putting together lots of plaques that build up a whole story, which might have an overall visual effect rather like Bharud, Sanchi or Amravati, by putting lots of these plaques together on a wooden construction. So it seems to me more likely that they would have been put around stupas where a wooden armature has given way. And what we have only are the terracotta decorative plaques that are now left from the armature but are dismembered and are not in any logical sequence for us. Meanwhile, let's come to another group of objects which further strengthens our case. And this is a very curious case, recent research that has been done on Buddhist monasteries in Bihar by a team of Japanese and British archaeologists working in Vaishali and sites around there, in the Jetavana forest particularly, in Shravasti, have found that inside the monastery, excavating inside the monastery, they found a large number of figures that are called nigamesas. Figures which have a bovine or an ungulate head, a head of a deer, a ram, or a cow.
Goat.
A goat. So, and a human body. The Nigamesha story is better known to us from Jain sources, where Hari Nigamesha performs the in vitro transfer of the fetus of Mahavir from the womb of Devananda to the womb of Trishula, right? From whom Mahavir is eventually born, transferring the fetus from a Brahmin woman's womb into a Kshatriya woman's womb, so that the child that is born is of indeterminate caste. This role that Nigamesha performs of transferring the embryo is very interesting, because even in other mythic circles, it seems like in Hindu myths on the birth stories of Skanda, or if you read Ayurvedic literature like the Kashyapa Samhita, in the sections that deal with pediatrics and gynecology, again there is reference to characters like Nigamesha. So it seems that Nigamesha is not being used only in the Jain context. Indeed, at Mathura, the stone sculptures of this character called Nigamesha are found in what might be a Brahmanical context. So it seems that everyone is using this deity as a fertility deity to safeguard pregnancies. And we know that the Buddhist monks used to perform a medical function out of the monasteries, where the monastic area has also been used as a hospital. The discovery of a number of these Nigameshas in Buddhist monasteries casts a whole new interpretation of what images are doing in an early Buddhist context, in Theravada Buddhist contexts. Theravada Buddhism is not supposed to have anything to do with fetish and the use of images. It is supposed to only have narratives for the edification of the population. But instead of moral narratives, what we are seeing in the Buddhist monastery itself are these magical charms and talismans, where the image is performing some magical quality. Those kinds of images are being found in the monastic area. So this is one example of that. I'm going to end my talk with a few slides which show incontrovertible evidence that Buddhism was being practiced in Chandraketavara. The first is this famous image of the sandstone image of a Buddha from Mathura in the classic Mathura style that was excavated in the only scientific excavations that have taken place in Chandraketavara in the 50s. This piece was excavated from Chandraketavara and deposited in the Ashutosh Museum. And few people have talked about the significance of the presence of a Mathura sandstone Buddha, an actual Buddha that has been found in Chandraketavara. Gaurishankar Day published in his Lost Civilization of Chandraketavara recently, in recent years, a book, in a photograph in which he showed this terracotta brick, which shows a Mathura style Buddha with two flanking characters, and it's a Karpardit Buddha sitting with a halo around him, again clearly showing a Buddha being found in the context of Chandraketavara once again. So the fact that the population of Chandraketavara is well versed in Buddhism cannot be doubted. In the end, I'm going to show a group of relic caskets made of ivory. I'm sorry, I only got low resolution pictures from this website, from this particular dealer's website. The interesting thing is that I'll show you another example of a single story relic casket, which shows the same variant stories of the life of the Bodhisattva carved on it. Why do I think that these caskets are of Buddhist thematics? You might well ask me. The evidence for that comes from, we're still on number 19, I'm going to come to number 20. Here we are. This particular casket. When I first encountered this, I was quite flabbergasted. Here we see a figure who is dressed like a royal, who is no longer on a horse, which is without a rider. Could it be on the other side of the casket? There is a four-headed lion on top of a dharma chakra, above which there is a small relic pot. That's clearly a scene which is referring to the idea of the nirvana. It is a Buddhist symbol par excellence. It's not only got the four-headed lion, but a relic casket on top of the lion and a dharma chakra under the lion, which is very interesting because it's an understanding of the story. It's not a mindless replication of iconography. On the other side is a figure that is seated in meditation. And you may well ask, but this is not Buddha. But the reason we don't say it as Buddha is only because he is not in the costume of Buddha, the costume that we would imagine him to be wearing in UP. Because our minds have been conditioned by the images of UP. Right? And on top of the casket, right on top, we get a figure who is reclining, and I'm at a loss to interpret it satisfactorily. It has a peacock associated with it again. It might be a reference to the idea of a birth scene. It might be a reference like the birth scene, so the peacock in the beginning. It might be coming back to the very same iconography with which we started, which would make the story of birth to departure, to meditation, to dhyana, and to the nirvana on the casket complete. But it would be a mythic cycle of the great episodes of the life of the Buddha, but shown from a completely different perspective, which is a local costuming of that story. I don't know if I have come upon a conclusive set of evidence, but I would like to share with you all is that it seems to be a fairly plausible set of interpretative strategies that are now building up in one's mind. My attempt today was to try and share with you data that I have been trying to piece together over the years to try and come up with some interpretation and some strategy for interpretation. And I've tried to share with you what hindrances there are in trying to understand a lot of this material because it is not coming to us neatly. I'm sure with everyone's collaboration and with many more scholars working in the field together, we'll be able to piece these things together. But I think that what I'm trying to get at is that I don't think we should expect simple and easy solutions. And I think that our rereading of the material of Mathura and Gandhara, and to understand the controversies of the texts, and to understand the controversies of the shifts in the minor schools of Theravada into the minor schools of Mahayana, needs to be understood with much greater care by us. Because these bits of evidence that we are looking at over here are germane to our understanding if we are to get a more correct assessment of the nature of how early Buddhism was actually practiced by people in their homes rather than just publicly put on display in the monuments which we have been studying till now. Thank you. Be happy to address any questions if you have any. Can we have the lights back on, please?
Thank you, Raghu. Jagdeep, interesting presentation, although there are questions, there are doubts that I'm sure the speaker will be subjected to a number of queries. But I agree that it has been a very interesting presentation, although I must admit that I have not seen the material, much of the material, in Naman's personal archive. I would have liked to see them original. And since Nataka has now doesn't state it, they are present whereabouts. I don't think they are in museums now, they are still in private collection. So they are, as somebody who had always been associated with official archaeological establishment, I'll be little skeptical about objects in private collection. But this is a very interesting presentation and it calls for a review of the whole issue. So, let's have questions. Any question? Yes.
From Chandragiri to Garh, it was going to Odisha and then to Southeast Asia. Actually, I got the chance to visit the Udaipuri, Ratnagiri, and Lalitgiri recently, and there I saw the Buddhism or the Buddhist statues there, which were more resembles to the Gandhara style.
Are you suggesting that Ratnagiri, Lalitgiri, Udaipuri?
Sculptures
over there are close to Gandhara.
Yes, sir.
In which way? How are they close to Gandhara? This is a absolutely new new information. How are they close to Gandhara?
Sir,
why do you think they are close to Gandhara?
The pictures, the monuments which are there.
What is your question? Yeah.
What is your question? You want me to talk about that?
Yes, sir.
Actually, as Vasundhara just said, I don't think that there is a direct connection with Gandhara. There is an indirect connection, and indeed, even in Vietnam, in the Mekong Delta, we have been finding Gandhara objects in the past 5-7 years, which has been startling because it seems that the trade of the Kushans went from the coast of Bengal to Southeast Asia, and remarkable things are coming up. However, as you've just heard, if the stone statues of that we get in Udaipuri and other sites that we're talking about, they don't really have a Gandharan influence on them. The mere presence of pleated garments should not indicate to you that it is always a Gandharan influence. Pleated garments can exist in Sanchi also and in other parts also. It's the nature of the pleating and the kind of robes that figures wear and the body type, etc., which can show. So look at the figures more carefully. I don't think it is really related to Gandhara.
Let us come to the more important formulations of Dr. Ahuja. The presence of, or let us say, Buddhist affiliation of a set of formulations of Gita, which is a very, very important. Do you have any question on that?
Sir, your lecture is very wonderful. And I think so in Bengal, is there any stylistic development in
another tradition of Buddhism that was being practiced in Gandhara, which was not the same as the dominant form of Buddhism that we have learnt was being practiced in central India? In any case, most of the myths and stories that we know of Theravada Buddhism were reconstructed on the basis of the Sri Lankan canon of Buddhism, and not taking into account the Southeast Asian canon of Theravada Buddhism. You see, for those of you who may not know, and these experts should forgive me for stating certain obvious things, the whole history of reconstructing Buddhism in the 19th century in India was done on the basis of certain texts that were rediscovered in Sri Lanka. because Buddhism was all but dead in the Indian subcontinent. And that was used as the basis for the reconstruction for what the early Buddhist stories and narratives were about. So reading the Sri Lankan chronicles, people were able to identify the stories of Bharut and Sanchi and so on. This was correlated with a group of texts that was later discovered from Tibet. And those Tibetan texts were used to also try and helpfully reconstruct, Chinese and Tibetan texts were used to reconstruct what was happening in India. It's only now that another group of texts has been found, which is from Gandhara, which are from Gandhara, that are showing us a parallel system of Buddhism that might have been active in their regional school over there. In recent years, a lot of work has been done by, for instance, Peter Skilling, who works in Thailand, who has shown that Southeast Asia had its own traditions of Theravada Buddhism, which they probably inherited directly from Bengal. It's likely, therefore, that there was a variant tradition of Theravada Buddhism that was active in the region of Bengal and coming down the coast to Orissa that we don't really have evidence, textual evidence for. These kinds of plaques may be evidence for a slightly different reading of the Jatakas as they might have existed in Eastern India at that time. And that is why this visual evidence is particularly relevant for us. Let's look at another grander example. This big plaque shows a figure who is outside a palace gate. And the figure has a lotus-shaped pedestal under him. He holds a kamandal in his hand. He has a halo behind him. He has an unusual gesture. And this gesture comes up repeatedly in the images of Bengal. It is not Abhaya Mudra with a straight patak. It is in fact the Vajra Mushti, which is the hand bent in a cupped gesture. And it is very curious that repeatedly we find these images in Bengal of Buddhas all the way up to the 5th century that show a convention of the hand in this gesture rather than this gesture, which is the norm in Uttar Pradesh. Right? So whereas for UP and west of UP, that is the gesture of the straight patak, it seems that the earliest images in Bengal deploy a slightly different gesture. Again, what's interesting is everyone seems to have gathered, there is a procession, somebody is passing a kamandal down from an upper balcony to a figure in the procession that is marching through this palace gateway. And everyone seems to be coming out of the palace into the area of the forest where animals and men have gathered to salute this holy figure. Who could this figure be? Could this be a depiction of the great departure and Buddhahood? Or could this be, because of the water pot in his hand, be a depiction of Maitreya? The idea that it might be Maitreya and this gesture can be found in another group of pieces, and I'm sorry I don't have good quality pictures. These were photographed when I was doing field work in some of the islands of the Sundarbans, and they were taken on a phone in a hurry when the people who were discovering the pieces were not really well disposed towards me, to put it mildly, and not really keen for me to use my camera to take the kind of pictures I was. So for instance, this is one of those extraordinarily large pots. I don't know if you can make out, I'm sorry about the poor quality of the picture, but there is a figure in the center who also has a kamandal in his hand, a halo behind him, his hand in the same, held in the same pose, and people are worshipping him all around. Again, in much the same way that we saw in the previous plaque over here. Now this plaque again has been scientifically tested in many different laboratories. It gives us a very clearly 2nd century AD date. This has not been scientifically dated. I put this out to everyone. I've seen this. I saw it on the coming out of the where they found it at that time, but I'm told it has been purchased by an Indian art collector, so it's still within our country. And it's one of those, where we're lucky that it's one of those pieces which is still in India that has this rich iconography. Now, building up the case for Bodhisattvas, I'd like to show you this particular ivory wrangle. This remarkable object, when I first encountered it about 12 or 15 years ago, I thought that I had found evidence for the Hindu deity Agni, because Agni is always shown riding a ram. And I went down the line of research for many years, probably because I was reading too many popular Bengali novels or something at some stage, or was being narrated to me. And I began to think of Chandraketu Garh and the name Chandraketu and this idea of the grahas and the idea of how the different planets are so important, and how iconography of something like Agni, who is one of the Dikpals, might have an older system, an iconographic system in Bengal, and how Brahmanical deities might have been there. And I was thinking all of these things for a long time till I realized I was being completely foolish one day, when an object that I had always known all my life came back to see me. And when I saw it again, which is of course this very famous Gandhara statue in the Victoria and Albert Museum that shows the Prince Siddharth being taken to school. And of course it's true that in the early Buddhist literature, in the Jatakas, it says that Siddharth was taken to school on a cart pulled by rams. And it was beautifully depicted in Gandhara about five or six times. This is the best example. And you can see how the iconography of the boy being taken on a cart pulled by rams is similar to what we find from Chandraketu Garh in ivory. What's the similarity? What's the difference? There is a similarity in the mythic narrative, in the content. There is dissimilarity in the costuming. Is that so unreasonable? That Buddha might be dressed and Siddharth might be dressed differently in Bengal to how he was dressed in Afghanistan? Must we expect complete parallels in iconographic systems at a time when the iconography is only just emerging and just being developed for the first time, when it is at such a nascent stage in its development? Will there not naturally be variations where every region of India experiments and shows their deity in their own way? Now let's move away from Bodhisattvas and let's look at something else. Buddhist stupas are mostly associated with stories of Jataks, and the Jatakas are animal fables. Now the curious thing about these animal fables is that they could be Hindu or they could be Buddhist very easily. If you are following the Brihat Katha and the Hetopadesh or the Panchatantra, the story has a Hindu reference point. But the same story of the elephant and the crocodile will be there in a Jataka context. What is also interesting is that outside stupas, you often have these talismanic morphed creatures. Winged elephants, griffins, sphinxes are very common. If you look at, for instance, Sanchi Stupa 2 or Mathura, you will find a number of sculptures of these morphed creatures. And we find exactly these at the same time from the Chandraketu Garh terracottas. Could it not be that a number of these plaques were attached to a wooden armature of some domestic or some local stupas, where the wooden armature has been destroyed, or we sometimes find large wooden posts, but we don't know how these terracotta plaques were used. And it seems likely that if we attach lots of these terracotta plaques together, we can build up complex tableaus where large narratives can be constructed by putting together lots of plaques that build up a whole story, which might have an overall visual effect, rather like Bharut, Sanchi or Amaravati, by putting lots of these plaques together on a wooden construction. So it seems to me more likely that they would have been put around stupas where the wooden armature has given way, and what we have only are the terracotta decorative plaques that are now left from the armature, but are dismembered and are not in any logical sequence for us. Meanwhile, let's come to another group of objects which further strengthens our case. And this is a very curious case, recent research that has been done on Buddhist monasteries in Bihar by a team of Japanese and British archaeologists working in Vaishali and sites around there, in the Jetavana forest particularly, in Shravasti, have found that inside the monastery, excavating inside the monastery, they found a large number of figures that are called nigamesas. Figures which have a bovine or an ungulate head, a head of a deer, a lamb, or a cow.
Goat.
A goat. So, and a human body. The Nagamesha story is better known to us from Jain sources, where Hari Nagamesha performs the in vitro transfer of the fetus of Mahavir from the womb of Devananda to the womb of Trishula, right? From whom Mahavir is eventually born, transferring the fetus from a Brahmin woman's womb into a Kshatriya woman's womb, so that the child that is born is of indeterminate caste. This role that Nagamesha performs of transferring the embryo is very interesting, because even in other mythic circles, it seems like in Hindu myths and the birth stories of Skanda, or if you read Ayurvedic literature like the Kashyapa Samhita, in the sections that deal with pediatrics and gynecology, again there is reference to characters like Nagamesha. So it seems that Nagamesha is not being used only in the Jain context. Indeed, at Mathura, the stone sculptures of this character called Nagamesha are found in what might be a Brahmanical context. So it seems that everyone is using this deity as a fertility deity to safeguard pregnancies. And we know that the Buddhist monks used to perform a medical function out of the monasteries, where the monastic area has also been used as a hospital. The discovery of a number of these Nagameshas in Buddhist monasteries casts a whole new interpretation of what images are doing in an early Buddhist context, in Theravada Buddhist contexts. Theravada Buddhism is not supposed to have anything to do with fetish and the use of images. It is supposed to only have narratives for the edification of the population. But instead of moral narratives, what we are seeing in the Buddhist monastery itself are these magical charms and talismans, where the image is performing some magical quality. Those kinds of images are being found in the monastic area. So this is one example of that. I'm going to end my talk with a few slides which show incontrovertible evidence that Buddhism was being practiced in Chandraketavara. The first is this famous image of the sandstone image of a Buddha from Mathura, in the classic Mathura style, that was excavated in the only scientific excavations that have taken place in Chandraketavara in the 50s. This piece was excavated from Chandraketavara and deposited in the Ashutosh Museum. And few people have talked about the significance of the presence of a Mathura sandstone Buddha, an actual Buddha that has been found in Chandraketavara. Gaurishankar Dey published in his Lost Civilization of Chandraketavara recent years, a book in a photograph in which he showed this terracotta brick, which shows a Mathura style Buddha with two flanking characters, and it's a Karpardit Buddha sitting with a halo around him, again clearly showing a Buddha being found in the context of Chandraketavara once again. So the fact that the population of Chandraketavara is well versed in Buddhism cannot be doubted. In the end, I'm going to show a group of relic caskets made of ivory. I'm sorry, I only got low resolution pictures from this website, from this particular dealer's website. But the interesting thing is that I'll show you another example of a single story relic casket, which shows the same variant stories of the life of the Bodhisattva carved on it. why do I think that these caskets are of Buddhist thematics? You might well ask me. The evidence for that comes from, sorry, we're still on number 19, I'm going to come to number 20. Here we are. This particular casket. When I first encountered this, I was quite flabbergasted. Here we see a figure who is dressed like a royal, who is no longer on a horse, which is without a rider. Could it be on the other side of the casket, there is a four-headed lion on top of a dharma chakra, above which there is a small relic pot. That's clearly a scene which is referring to the idea of the nirvana. It is a Buddhist symbol par excellence. It's not only got the four-headed lion, but a relic casket on top of the lion and a dharma chakra under the lion, which is very interesting because it's an understanding of the story. It's not a mindless replication of iconography. On the other side is a figure that is seated in meditation. And you may well ask, but this is not Buddha. But the reason we don't say it as Buddha is only because he is not in the costume of Buddha, the costume that we would imagine him to be wearing in UP. Because our minds have been conditioned by the images of UP. Right? And on top of the casket, right on top, we get a figure who is reclining, and I'm at a loss to interpret it satisfactorily. It has a peacock associated with it again. It might be a reference to the idea of a birth scene. It might be a reference like the birth scene, so the peacock in the beginning. It might be coming back to the very same iconography with which we started, which would make the story of birth to departure, to meditation, to dhyana, and to the nirvana on the casket complete. But it would be a mythic cycle of the great episodes of the life of the Buddha, but shown from a completely different perspective, which is a local costuming of that story. I don't know if I have come upon a conclusive set of evidence, but I would like to share with you all is that it seems to be a fairly plausible set of interpretative strategies that are now building up in one's mind. My attempt today was to try and share with you data that I have been trying to piece together over the years to try and come up with some interpretation and some strategy for interpretation. And I've tried to share with you what hindrances there are in trying to understand a lot of this material because it is not coming to us neatly. I'm sure with everyone's collaboration and with many more scholars working in the field together, we'll be able to piece these things together. But I think that what I'm trying to get at is that I don't think we should expect simple and easy solutions. And I think that our rereading of the material of Mathura and Gandhara, and to understand the controversies of the texts, and to understand the controversies of the shifts in the minor schools of Theravada into the minor schools of Mahayana, needs to be understood with much greater care by us. Because these bits of evidence that we are looking at over here are germane to our understanding if we are to get a more correct assessment of the nature of how early Buddhism was actually practiced by people in their homes rather than just publicly put on display in the monuments which we have been studying till now. Thank you. I'd be happy to address any questions if you have any. Can we have the lights back on, please?
Thank you, Raman. It has been an interesting presentation. Although there are questions, there are doubts that I'm sure the speaker will be subjected to a number of queries. But I agree that it has been a very interesting presentation, although
that I have not seen the material, much of the material in Naman's personal archive. I would have liked to see them in original. And since Naman has not, Naman doesn't stay in their present whereabouts. I don't think they are in museums now, they are still in private collection. So they are, as some of you have already associated with official archaeological establishment, I'll be little skeptical about objects in private collection. But this is a very interesting presentation and it calls for a review of the whole issue. So let's have questions. Any question? Yes.
From Chandragiri to Garh, it was going to Odisha and then to Southeast Asia. Actually, I got the chance to visit the Udaygiri, Ratnagiri, and Lalitgiri recently, and there I saw the Buddhism or the Buddhi statues there, which were more resembles to the Gandhara style.
Are you suggesting that Ratnagiri, Lalitgiri, Udaygiri? This is the new Udaygiri, this side.
Yes.
They are, this is the sculptures over there are close to Gandhara.
Yes, sir.
In which way? How are they close to Gandhara? This is a absolutely new set of new information. How are they close to Gandhara? Why do you think they are close to Gandhara?
The
total,
the type, the total, the features, the monuments which are there.
Started because it seems that the trade of the Kushans went from the coast of Bengal to Southeast Asia, and remarkable things are coming up. However, as you just heard, the stone statues of that we get in Udaygiri and other sites that you are talking about, they don't really have a Gandharan influence on them. The mere presence of pleated garments should not indicate to you that it is always a Gandhara influence. Pleated garments can exist in Sanchi also and in other parts also. It's the nature of the pleating and the kind of robes that figures wear and the body type, etc., which can show. So look at the figures more carefully. I don't think it is really related to Gandhara. Okay.
Let us come to the more important formulations. Dr. Ahuja, the presence of, or let us say, Buddhist affiliation of a set of Chandragiri, which is very, very important. Do you have any question on that?
Sir, your lecture is very honorable, and I think so in Bengal. Is there any stylistic development
or Mahayana Buddhism later on, by which time image worship becomes well established in the Indian subcontinent. I mention these ideas as something of a background because the material that I am going to be looking at from Chandragiri and from the sites around which Vidishamu will compare it have to be contextualized in this broader religious background of what is happening to image worship and to image and to religious narratives. That's the larger context within which we must study our images. Now, Bengal is not the only region which is rich in these kinds of images. These images have been found from all over the Indian subcontinent. The first image of the type that was ever discovered was this figure. It comes from Tomluk and it is now at the Ashmolean Museum in Oxford. In about 1870, it was put before the Asiatic Society here in Calcutta at a meeting, and a number of people deliberated on this image and on this plaque that had been found, and then mysteriously disappeared from Calcutta, and it turned up at the Indian Institute in Oxford in 1920, where Johnston, the famous Sanskrit scholar, discovered it. And then when the Ashmolean Museum had a new premises, it was put into the Ashmolean Museum. And it has intrigued scholars ever since its discovery. It is the most written about plaque of the Shunga period, and it is considered the great exemplar and the great great prototype that everyone studies. I'm just going to briefly look at it with you. As you can see, this is the stand. As I was saying, it's a very typical type of figure. So most of these terracottas are punched out of molds. The molds are extremely refined. They show a lady very often standing with five hairpin-like projections that come out of her hairdo. She seems to wear an elaborate turban. They're usually five, but they're not always five. They can be 10 or 12, sometimes as few as three. In some parts of India, the five weapons on one side are counterbalanced by five sprigs of foliage on the other side. She's always very elaborately jeweled. I've written separate articles on understanding and analyzing the talismans on her body. If one really takes a zoom lens and a macro, does some macro photography, one can notice that the pendants that are falling on her thighs are actually in the shape of small Bharvahak yakshas. And the pendants which are on her torso are actually figures of small animals with a fish tail, an elephant with a fish tail, or a bird which is flying, or a deer which has wings, and other such features. So mythical composite creatures, partly different animals being put together to create some fantastic beasts which have been put across her torso. I'm sorry, the magnification is not enough to see that over here. Now, the curious thing is that the dating of the sites in the Bengal Delta is actually a very tricky thing for archaeologists to establish. Whereas in the rest of India, we get archaeological sites which are in the shape of mounds, and then you can very neatly achieve strata, and then you can dig down. The Bengal Deltaic area is so waterlogged that after about 8 to 10 feet of soil, you come into slide. You come into a pretty wet, waterlogged territory. And the deeper you go, the amount of water just keeps increasing, and the clay is constantly churning. And actually, you're not just digging in, you're not digging in soil, you're digging in a kind of a liquid clay. And it's a very curious thing, because every time there are major tidal shifts, the soil under the land, the water under the land, is also affected by that. And you're not going to get neat stratigraphy like the way you get the kind of stratas that you get for dating that you get in the rest of the subcontinent. It also seems, as now current research has shown from the work being done in Mahasthangarh, that it seems that the settlement of the deltaic region, the 24 Parganas area, happens much later in history. And this really is one of the, although the upper reaches of Bengal have a much older history, these lower portions of Bengal get settled only at a much later date, from the early Mauryan into the Kushan period. What happens during that period is that the settlements keep shifting. Chandraketugarh is not a single site. Chandraketugarh is in fact a site that is spread well over 8 square kilometers. 8 square kilometers, yes, certainly, but actually the series of habitations seem to continue and extend all the way down the delta. And in fact, there are even portions in the Sundarbans that have revealed objects which are quite similar to what we find in Chandraketugarh. In that case, the question becomes that is this such a major urban settlement, all inhabited at one time? No, it's not. It seems that it is a migratory population that is moving from one settlement zone into another all the way along this area, and the objects keep developing in style. So you can see things from one portion of the broader Chandraketugarh zone, as I should call it, rather than the site, because it is not a single site, which shows evidence of a certain group of, from a certain date, and then you move to the next village and you see material from maybe 100 years later or maybe 50 years later, and then you move a little bit beyond and you see things which are made a few decades later. So it seems that it's a shifting population, and that can create certain curious objects. It also needs to be said that the stylistic development that we see in Bengal has a slightly different trajectory to what we find in the rest of the Indian subcontinent. So some of the more recent discoveries that have been coming out from Murshidabad area, for instance, and from Bangladesh, just across the Khai, you get objects like these little Gupta period images of the Buddha, but the flanking figures that you see on either side seem to be dressed in a Satvahana or a Kushan costume, especially with regard to their turban. Now, this causes certain curiosities in one's mind if one looks at this related figure, again, a sort of a Gandhara style drapery inspired by that, but the way the figures are shown praying to the central figure at the bottom are very much in the style of Amaravati and Nagarjuna Konda Satvahana figures. Or this one where you see a very direct correlation with a Mathura style in the central figure. So although the central figure is of a Gupta style, these are supposed to be finds in the region of Murshidabad, Karnasuvarna, going across the border to Darshahi in that zone where these objects are being discovered. They bespeak a slightly different chronological and stylistic development compared to what we find in the rest of the Indian subcontinent, an admixture of styles, which is curious. All the scientific tests that have been done on these objects from multiple laboratories in the world corroborate that these are about the 5th century AD. But these are not the kind of objects that I really want to talk about. I only brought these up to show you that the chronological development of style in Bengal is curious and not exactly like what we find in the rest of India. The kind of objects I'm more interested in speaking about today are amongst those thousands of terracotta plaques that have been found, which remain like nameless deities, the nameless little plaques that we don't know who they are representing. Might be one seat over here in front if somebody wants to sit down. And if you don't mind sitting on the floor, there's some space here in front, you'll get a clear view. It's better than standing at the back. Okay. The kind of plaques that I'm more interested in, that have been curious, have been these figures, which show a lady sometimes standing next to a freestanding pillar. This particular one, the lady is clearly in a tribhanga. She's got some attitude of dance, her arms are raised. She has a small cat beside her. But the pillar which is next to her, that freestanding pillar, is very curious. It shows on top of it four elephants with their trunks raised. And above it, there is a Bharvahak. You can't see the Bharvahak because he is partly concealed by the lady's elbow and partly concealed by the peacock's plume. And the peacock sits right on top. So you can see just the hand of the Bharvahak there and the foot behind. So there is a Bharvahak sitting behind the peacock, and then there are these elephants, and then there is the freestanding pillar. Now, we often wonder, what was the cult of the freestanding pillar associated with in ancient India? And I have another detailed study that, apart from any other reason, any other meanings that might be associated with the freestanding pillar, one of them was, of course, the cult of fertility. And that fertility aspect is borne out by another plaque that shows a mother bringing a young boy to pray along with a plate of offerings to a similar freestanding pillar, again with the elephants on top and again a peacock seated right on top. So what we are being able to see in a number of cases is that the cult of the pillar is not unrelated to the cult of fertility, which is being associated with a lot of these figures. Now, what I'm going to come to and show how is this distinctly associated with any cult that is Buddhist in nature, and why should we be linking such practices, such ritual practices, with Buddhism? Keep that thought in your mind, because we will come back to it after looking at some other evidence. This is going to be a slightly cumbersome journey. The evidence has to be built up in stages. It's not going to be immediate. You're not going to see the connections. Okay, so let's get back to the Tomluk Yakshi, and let's look at her iconography. The curious thing is that we could never understand what this figurine meant. Why was this figurine made the way it is? Now, if we look at this old Archaeological Survey of India photograph of the excavations from the Piparava Stupa, which is, as we know, the most sacred of the ancient Buddhist stupas, which was most likely to contain the Buddha's own ashes, it contained inside one of its relic caskets this gold plaque. There was some controversy whether it was from Lodhiyanandangarh or from Piparava. There are other objects which are from Lodhiyanandangarh, which I'll also be showing you presently. If you look at this lady carefully, you'll see that she has the same projectiles from her head. And that seems to indicate that the lady with the ayudhas is not somebody who is only to be interpreted as Lakshmi or Proto Durga or something, but also to be looked upon as somebody who is so important that she is kept along with the asthis of the Buddha inside a relic casket in the stupa. In the most sacred part of a Theravada stupa, inside the relic casket, you put an anthropomorphic figure. Now, the rise of the question of anthropomorphism in Indian art has always been linked to the rise of the Buddha image. But here we see that in the most sacred ancient stupas, a different kind of figure is being put inside the relic casket. Of course, one could make the argument that they were just interested in putting something made of gold inside the relic casket. Like, after all, in Gandhara, they put the coin of Kanishka inside a relic casket. They don't necessarily have to put the image that they put inside the relic casket does not need to have some meaning associated with it. It could just be there because it is made of gold. That would be okay, I would believe that argument, were it not for the fact that the other casket also contained a gold plaque. And that contained a gold plaque of this kind. You can see where you can see just the outline of a figure, a broad-hipped woman. Her pudendum is clearly visible. Her arms are falling by her side. This one was found at Lodhiyanandangarh. Again, it's in this museum's collection. A third one we can look at, which also comes from Piparava, shows this particular lady with her arms falling by her side. More gold in this case. There seems to be a regular occurrence of putting an image of one of these goddesses inside relic caskets in Eastern India. In the most ancient relic caskets, not in the caskets of Madhya Pradesh and not in the caskets of Punjab or Sanghor or beyond in Gandhara, but let's look at the caskets of Bihar and UP and Bengal and see the kind of the borderlands of Bengal and see what are the kind of things we're getting from there. Because those are, of course, the more ancient stupas. And it seems that this goddess seems to be in all of them. Now, for those of you who are students of Indian archaeology, will immediately be able to recognize that the shape of this lady is none other than the kind of figure that we find inside the ring stones and disc stones of the Mauryan period, where we find the same kind of figure is made inside these mysterious Mauryan ring stones. And we've never been able to fully understand what was the meaning behind these Mauryan ring stones. So what is building up is that the same kind of lady is obviously so important that she is placed inside the relic casket. Now moving on, I'd like to look at another example. Although we found examples of her in gold and in clay, sometimes in bronze, there's one very famous example in bronze, which is in the Metropolitan Museum in New York. There is one example which has been found which is made out of stone. And the stone one also comes from a Buddhist context. And that is unusual, it comes from South India. It comes from Goli. Now, this is a life-size sculpture. If it was complete, it would be 5 feet high. And if you look at her carefully, she has these pin-type projections coming out of her head on both sides. The sculptures of Goli are dated to about 300 to 350 AD. It's a late site. It's made out of Palmer limestone. Excavated is not the right word to use. It was picked up by Jouveau Dupri, who took the sculptures over and deposited them with his friend, the very famous art dealer called C.T. Lou, who had a shop in Paris. And from Paris, the sculptures of Goli made their way, like the Kanchipuram Yoginis, to many museums in the Western world. The sculptures that C.T. Lou, this particular sculpture, was bought by Douglas Barrett, the former curator of Indian art at the British Museum, for the British Museum's collection in the 1950s, 1955 it was accessioned. And you'll see that it has an inscription right on top. I made a rubbing of the inscription. I tried to get some aksharas out of it. My speculative writing of the aksharas is not to be followed. It's very hard to make out what is written in that. The inscription is very weathered. The point is not what the inscription says or doesn't say. The point is that this is an object which is, here is a cross-sectional drawing. This portion is the only portion that is occupied by the piece of stone right now. It has this lenticular mortise cut into it on one side. It would have had two such mortises. One side also has evidence of a mortise into which the Vedika railing pillar, the crossbars, would have slotted. So this is that. What is surviving is this portion of the Vedika railing pillar. And that means that this was a sculpture outside a Buddhist stupa. Once again, we find that the lady with the projectiles, I don't know what other word to use, the lady with the projectiles is found in a Buddhist context. So not only is she found inside the relic casket of some of the most ancient stupas, she can also be found now on a Vedika, right from the late Satvahana Ikshvaku period. Now let's move away from these goddesses. Let's try and build up the case for another group of figures. And I'm now going to come that if Buddhism is being practiced in Eastern India in the domestic environment, this should not be limited to just these mysterious goddesses. It should also be there with other types of standard Buddhist figures. So I'm going to examine this figure with which I began my talk, which shows a plaque that is now, that could be interpreted either as a Maitreya or it could be interpreted as Siddharth, as the Gautam Buddha, actually. I'll come to my interpretation of that in a second. I want you to look at what is going on. There is a figure under a tree. A monkey is peeping from the tree, looking upon the scene, and all the ladies and people who are gathered around him are awestruck by him. Many of them fold their hands. They are struck by this man The curious thing about this man is not that he holds this object. It's not really a kamandal, but it could be something like a kamandal in his hand. If we interpret it as a kamandal, then clearly it is Maitreya. The more interesting feature about him is, look at his feet. Under his feet, there seems to be two tree trunks, or something that looks like tree trunks, which has lots of stripes on it. If we zoom into that and look at that really carefully, it could be interpreted as two tree trunks, but it's more likely to be gushing water coming out from under his feet. This is very much like the story of the Buddha's miracle of Shravasti and the other times when he is supposed to have descended from Tushita heaven, when he is shown in Gandhara many times in the same way, with water coming out of his feet and fire coming out of his shoulders. However, in contemporary sculptures from the Ikshvaku period in Nagarjunakonda, wherever they show the descent of the Buddha, they don't show the fire or the water. It is simply understood that the Buddha, who is shown levitating, is shown simply levitating, not being stuck in the sky, performing the miracle, not shown with the water or the flames that we find in Gandhara. But for those of you who are not familiar, let me show you what the Gandhara ones are like. This, for instance, is the very famous one that is in the collection of the Musée Guimet, which shows the Buddha with the flames and the water under his feet, water under each foot. The one in the Musée Feenisch Kunst in Berlin, again, has the water under the feet and the flames. And here, our figure also has the same water under the feet. So what I'm trying to say is that what we have been doing is retroactively reading the iconography of Buddhism on the basis of the way in which Buddhism was imaged in Mathura, in Gandhara, in Sanchi. And to say that this is what the iconography of Buddha should be like. We've not actually thought that there could have been a parallel system of iconography that might have been valid in Bengal, where the same myth is being shown to us, but with a different attire, a different iconographic system, a different hairstyle and a different costume. Why is it necessary that all parts of India should be following exactly the same costuming method at the same time? Why is it not possible that Bengal had its own regional tradition of Buddhism? Now, for Buddhist scholars, this is becoming increasingly important to recognize this difference, because the discovery of the Pali of the texts that are coming out of Gandhara, the Kharoshthi manuscripts which are coming out of Gandhara, are revealing to us a pattern.